What does the land mean to me? The land is something very sacred.
The land, like, it literally translates to Mother Earth. When you translate it from Navajo, that's the literal translation.
I was born and raised here.
I've grown up on this land.
This is the same land that my grandparents and parents have been able to sustain their cattle operations.
It means where I'm from. It's like asking someone, what do your parents mean to you? What do your children mean to you?
Growing up in the Navajo tradition, we are taught to have a very close relationship with the land. Our elders have taught us that we call Earth Mother Earth.
It's a relationship, just like it's a relative to us.
It kind of defines who we are as Haymus people. You know, we take pride in being agriculturalists. We're farmers first and foremost, but there's a few of us that do want to make a living in ranching. The scenery, I don't think, gets any better than it is. We've got the mountains to the east of us that we enjoy. We've got these areas to graze our cattle in.
Our backyard is the Grand Canyon, you know?
It's Mother Earth. It's what takes care of us for not only Native Americans, but everybody else.
Yeah, it really changed. I used to see a lot of flowers, all different colors. And then I could see the grass so high. And then there wasn't scarce of water. The water tank was always full. And all together was a friendship with my animals, with the land, and so did my neighbors.
A lot of the tribes, one of their biggest resources is rangeland. To me, I think over the last 100 or so years, we built a culture that we have pride in. You know, a lot of our tribes, like the Navajos, would move around at one time, you know, maybe graze over an 80-mile span. And they would multi-species graze, not just cattle. And then once the reservation system was put into place, it limited them to just a few mile area. And then that's when we started running into overgrazing issues.
As people, as human beings, with our five fingers and ability to walk around, we're really powerful. It's our responsibility to use that power that we have to take care of the land. It can't speak for itself. If we have too many cows out here, or we're not taking care of the soil and we don't have good water, like, it can't tell us that. So we have to be the ones to advocate for the land.
You know, a lot of it has to do with our economy. You know, a lot of these tribes are facing 60 to 70% unemployment. It got us to a point now where we have very limited infrastructure, but we still have the natural resource.
Our ancestors has left here for us what God has created and the importance of the soil.
You know, we all want development, and we want it for economic development, but we need to find a balance between conservation and preservation and protection.
Everything is interconnected.
Everything we do has an impact on our people.
I like to think about grazing as a checkbook, where your land is your money, and If you're constantly withdrawing or grazing too much, you're gonna overdraw. Who's gonna pay for that? It'll be future generations.
This land is not ours. Some of us may hold title to the land. Some of us may have it in trust, but the land really belongs to the future generations that are not born yet. We're just borrowing it for a little while.
What we do to the land is what we get from the land. It's like reaping what we sow.
But we all have to make a commitment to make sure that we're keeping and sustaining the natural resources so that way future generations can utilize the same lands. The
next generation right now is pretty tough.
We have youth going out and getting educated, and then when they come back, there's nobody's making room for them at the table. So in that instance, I tell them, well, you know, you got to bring your own table and you can, you know, invite who you want there and start your own consulting business or farm or ranch business. It's going to be tough, but it's doable.
I think a lot of our teachings have to come from us as parents to teach our children the importance of ranching and farming.
In order to see something or leave something better than you thought, you need to educate people, build a relationship with people to the point where they can have an impact in a positive way too.
Having them understand what their role and responsibility is as caretakers of the land, and have them understand that we have a valuable place here, not only here on Hopi, but throughout the United States and throughout the world.
So we want to make sure there's an opportunity for them in the future so they can learn it and they can implement it and also, you know, make an income off of it.
That is one of the hardest things that we have had to deal with is overgrazing.
We started getting away from the herdsman mentality. When people had sheep, they always had to have a herdsman. We start to build a vicious cycle. Your cattle aren't gonna breed back because they don't have the nutrition to breed back. What I compare it to is a tragedy of the commons. And people, in their thinking, they're like, well, I'm gonna push my cattle over here and graze this area because it greens up faster than the higher elevations. And then everybody starts to push their cattle over there and they overuse that area and healing time to grow back. It just extends it. And then they go up to the higher elevation and then they overgraze that area. So it's just it's that cycle, you know, that mentality of beating everybody to the water trough.
To manage your land, you have to rotate your animals.
You use one area for, you know, short amounts of times and you watch the feed. And you have these plans in place so you don't overuse one area. And you rotate your pastures, you rotate your cattle in that pasture for that certain amount of days.
Instead of trying to fight Mother Nature, just be more in line with Mother Nature so you can have a better result.
Sometimes you have to sell your cow. Sometimes you have to let the place rest.
Some of that our great-great-grandparents understood, but now as we get more techie and everything, we start to lose touch with some of that.
If we can figure out a way to adapt and also incorporate some of the tribal knowledge and the land management knowledge that they have together, it would make it a lot easier. But I think we're slowly headed that way, and I think we need to not give up and keep improving on those things.
You know, there's politics in everything.
We're held back by laws, not only by state law, federal law, but we have tribal law.
People have to learn to graze their animals together. Animals will get along. It's the people that won't get along.
Your people are the hardest people to work with. Crabs in a bucket. You get put in a bucket and crabs, they're always pulling you down.
Some of the problems surround the way the Bureau of Indian Affairs and Congress has regulated the Native American lands.
I can remember my grandparents and his employees going out putting debris in washes to stop erosion. You can't do that anymore because of what it says in Army Code of Regulations that you cannot stop our waterway.
We need, you know, approval from our tribal leaders and also our traditional leaders and then also the community. So they, you know, they're all on board in what we're doing and they support it.
I think it's really important for our tribal governments to understand how important we think our natural resources are, especially our rangelands. We want to take care of it and we want to do a good job of being stewards to it, but we need the support of our tribal governments.
What I see from the tribal government part is that the tribe has spoiled them. People are overgrazing, they're mismanaging, and they're not paying their grazing fees. Put it back into the rangeland for water development, whatever.
And I'm hoping for direct opportunity for individual tribal ranchers, not based upon the tribal government process, but I want organizations and the federal government to understand that the individual tribal member should be able to write a grant also and receive that for the benefit of their livestock.
80% of it in turn is having a relationship with people, building relationships and networking and educating.
But also the importance of working with other outside entities, the federal government and the various different organizations that are out there that can provide opportunity to the tribal rancher.
Water is life on the reservation. If we have some raindrop, we put large buckets, containers under the roof, and we collect as many raindrops from the roofs to feed our animals.
Precipitation really dictates how the rest of your year is, or you know, it either makes or breaks your year.
I heard we've been in the drought since before I was born.
They're dry. Everything's dry. But except for this windmill that we have.
On our association, we get our water from 40 miles away through a pipeline. Without rainwater, we have reservoirs, earthen dams that are constructed, but they're all dry. So we're totally dependent on the transfer of water through a transmission line to drinkers and storage tanks.
I think we need to find a new way to tackle that drought instead of just waiting for it to be over, you know, because we could always fall into this cycle of another drought can happen, then we'd be stuck longer.
Well, if all the Navajo Nation listen to each other.
And if everybody works toward the common goal, I think the lands will come back to where they should be.
With the Native Coalition, I'm hoping that we could talk in a unified voice. I think anywhere you can get a coalition or an alliance together, you know, there's strength in numbers.
Making sure that we're educating each other. So when we have ranchers come together, that we're all sharing information and we're empowering ourselves to make good decisions into the future. I think forming a coalition would be something beneficial to us so that we can advocate for ourselves and advocate for conservation on tribal lands and advocate for fair marketing of our meat products.
As knowledge spreads and people are kind of opening up and to take on what's probably new to us, but has been part of the industry elsewhere for a long time, then that can open up markets for us.
But the only way for us to hit that critical number is to have people work together. Help them understand that they do have a quality product if we can get it to the market.
Every organization is beneficial depending on whether it meets its goal. Working with all of the other coalitions and other organizations that are out there is key. Not just the intellectual property that's passed down from one generation to the other, but the importance of science. In today's society, the way we move, as fast as we're moving, it's important to have good, sound practices based upon science.
Being able to use all of our knowledge that we have now and the knowledge that we're going to collect to have a foundation where people and our children can actually don't have to start as low as where we started from the beginning processes, where they can take off from where we ended.
So, you know, everybody has a piece to the puzzle, whether it's, you know, throughout the United States, all of our tribal nations own a piece to the puzzle. And once we start to solve the puzzle and put it into, you know, put it into place, and we realize, you know, what our overall goal is, I think that'll help everyone.
You know, the best way I think I want to leave this land for the future ranchers and so forth is just making sure that I do everything possible now to make it an easy transition for new ranchers down the road, whether it be my son or our other producers' kids. You know, we want to make sure that they're set up to continue the legacy of ranching on tribal lands.